like we're getting everybody situated. And as you're coming back to your seats, we'll go ahead and get started right. We'll get started with Scripture, and we can all say it together. Our Scripture together is Psalms 118:24. Let's say it together. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Amen. Well, I always start off, I try to start off with a little story or try to say something. But I heard something this week and I wanted to share it with you. I wanted to share it with you because it reminds us to look towards Jesus with intent. With intent, to look towards Him. So, John 1:29, John the Baptist says, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. Follow on later, it says in Luke 3:16, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I cometh, and he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. The following day, as John was standing with his two disciples, Jesus walked by. John looked at him intently and said, Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh the sins away of the world. If you look at Jesus intently, He will move for us. That's what God wants you to do. What Jesus wants you to do is look at Him with intent. When you have issues going on, when you have problems going on, when there's circumstances that are out of your hands, that is a time where I'm going to look at Jesus with intent, intently, and then we're going to start seeing the Word of God in our lives and that beginning of a start of a seed to start working in our lives. This morning, the message is the Word is a seed. So before we get started with that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we ask that you clear our minds and our hearts of all things. Dear Lord, we pray that you just help us focus on your Word and your Scripture today, that we can etch it inside our hearts that we may not sin against you. It is our prayer as believers that when people see us, they see less of us, but more of you each and every day. Dear God, we thank you that we have the opportunity to freely worship and be here this morning. Strengthen us in all ways. Help us be bold. Help us get into your Word this morning, Lord, that we can apply it in our everyday lives. Help this ministry continue to be a lighthouse for hope who all come in its path. We pray this in Jesus' blessed name. Amen. The Word is a seed. Mark 4:30-32, a story about the mustard seed, and I'll start here in verse 30. Then Jesus said, How can I show you what the kingdom of God is like? What story can I use to explain it? The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed, the smallest seed you plant on the ground. But when it is planted, the seed grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants. It produces large branches, and the wild birds can make nests in its shade. A seed has the ability to be so small, but yet it's planted, it can be the greatest, biggest tree that we'll ever, ever know. It is amazing what a seed can do. You've seen things like a weed break through concrete and just bust right through to grow. So many things, it's just unbelievable. It comes from just a small seed. Matthew 24:35, Jesus said, The heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. When the Bible says, the angel told Mary, no word of God shall be void of power. I want to let you know that that seed is the Word of God, and we apply it inside. Right there, God's Word says that His Word shall not be void of power. Of power. Whenever the Word is given, it has power. There's power in the name of Jesus. You see, one of the first things that Jesus gave to us the power and the authority is to use the name of Jesus. In that name, we can cast out demons and devils just by the name being proclaimed. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is healing in the name of Jesus. There is renewing in the name of Jesus. There is resurrection in the name of Jesus. Lazarus was raised from the dead by Jesus. The name of Jesus is an important, powerful thing that each and every one of us has. And he's given us through the Holy Spirit. Jeremiah 1:12. I will hasten my word to perform it. You know what that says? God watches over his word to perform it. That's what that's saying. I will hasten my word to perform it. God watches over his word to perform it. He's waiting for you to call upon the promises of his scripture. I will have life. I will have healing. By his stripes I am healed. When you start claiming the scripture and his promises, that's when God, he hears. He hears. He hears and he hears to that word. He loves you so much. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. He is a giver. He is a giver. What did he do? He gave. He gave his only begotten son. God is a giver, and he is there. But we have to understand his word is like a seed. And once we have that seed, then we start beginning that power. What does it say? Hebrews 4:12. Up on the screen it says, the word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Another translation says, the word of God is alive and full of power. We have power and authority with Jesus' word and with the Bible. The Bible, it gives us authority and power and word. But you know what? Some of us, I'm going to step off camera for a second. I'm going to grab a Bible. Some of us have these. We have these Bibles at home. And then what they are, they're almost like brand new. And they're dusty. And they're up there. And you're thinking, well, how am I going to get the power of the Lord? But look at that. It reminds me of a story that when the archaeologists were looking through the pyramids, they found a jar. And in that jar had seeds. And those seeds were 2,500 years old. What they did was take those 2,500-year-old seeds and they planted them. And you know what happened? They grew. They bear fruit. They grew. Well, a lot of us, we have these. And they're at home, the God's holy word, sitting there collecting dust. And a lot of them, it does seem like it's been sitting there 2,000 years in your house. You haven't touched it a bit. You haven't read it a bit. You put flowers, you put cards in it, or your pamphlet, or your bulletins in there to hold your special moments. But have you read it? Have you got in it? Well, you know what? If you start taking it, even though it may be you've had it sitting there for years and years and years, if you have it and you sow it, it's going to start producing fruit. It's going to start growing. Don't let it just sit there. This is the most powerful thing that we have, is the God's word. And that's why we're going through the scripture this morning. It says to go through them and be instant in and out of season. What does that mean? To be ready. To be ready and know. Now, I'm not asking you to memorize it and have Hebrews chapter. No, I'm asking you to know what God's word is. To know it. I know that Jesus died for me. I know what he's done. I know he's given me power and authority. That's what I'm calling upon, for you to have that authority. So when the devil comes, because he is alive and well, he wants you to forget. He wants you to be distracted. He wants you to think, what am I going to have for lunch today? What am I going to eat right now while you're sitting there? Did I leave the curling iron on? Did I do that? What's going on? Did I turn on the dishwasher? Everything else, he wants you to be so worried or what you're thinking about. Even the person next to you with the peanut wrapper. You're like, hey, really? It takes you that long to get it? You're going through it, and you're thinking, and you're thinking, and you're thinking. The devil wants you distracted because he comes in John 10:10 to kill, steal, and destroy. He wants to steal that word from you. Because if he can steal that word from your ears and hold it, you lack authority. You lack power. You lack victory. Because when you have that word, that's God's promises. That's his strength. That's what gives you victory and power and authority when you start playing with that. So the next part of John 10:10 is that he has come that you may have life, what? Abundantly. Not just enough to get by, just to barely make. No. Abundantly. For you to come and have life abundantly. That's what Jesus has come. So you can have life abundantly. So what? We can have substance. We can eat food, but it's not just that food. We need the word of God. Look at the scripture up here. Matthew 4:4. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. Living. I don't want you to be spiritually dyslexic and skinny and have no strength and no power. No, I want you to be spiritually strong by getting into the word. This morning, have you noticed all these scriptures? And so you can be fed. I hide his word within my heart that what? I may not sin against God. That's why we have that. We hide his word within our heart that we may not sin against God. And every morning, every Sunday morning, what do I have you recite? This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Why? Because repetition. We learned it in Sunday school. You do it 6 times and it becomes a habit. A habit. So it's important for us to make good habits. To be strengthened. And make these good, strong habits so we can be encouraged by God's strength and his power through his word. Isaiah 55:10-4. As the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and water of the earth, and make it bring forth blood, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goeth from out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the things whereto I sent. His word never goes void, and where it goes, it's going to accomplish. We believe that. We know that, and it will prosper. When we came to this church and we're praying that it's going to grow. We're praying that it's not going to grow in number, but in strength of spirit. And that it's going to keep moving and growing. It's like a seed. We didn't believe it. Some of us didn't believe it. Some of us didn't see it. There is no way possible. But it lives. But it lives. But it lives. There's life in Jesus. And it's growing. And it's growing. But in you, I'm praying for in spirit, when you have troubles and problems, but it grows. But it grows. And I can handle it. I can take it. Not today, Satan. No way. God has lived me. He's living in me. He's strengthening me. It's by that strength it grows. It grows. It grows. And by God's word, by receiving it, I can handle it. I can say no. I can say yes. I can say, yes, Lord, lead me, guide me. I know this is coming. I know you got a plan for me. I know that it's going to work. I may be in a storm right now, but I know that you are with me every step of the way. You know this. Because why? Luke 8:11. The seed is the word. I want to emphasize that. The seed is the word. We got to invite that seed. You are the one, the sower. The sower has the opportunity to give it, to throw it out, to tell people. But he also has the opportunity to plant the seed in here. To plant the seed in here. The sower. The sower of the seed. The sower soweth the word. Other translation, the farmer. The farmer sows the seed, the God of the word. He gives it out. He gives it out. Mark 4:14. The sower. Remember that. That is the emphasis. You are the sower. You have the opportunity. You can give the seed in your heart. You can start that little seed there. Or you can give it out. The sower soweth the word. And what is the word? The word of God. The incorruptible seed. You see that? The incorruptible seed.
God's word is preserved. God's word holds firm in your storms, in your troubles, in your trials, in your problems, with your finances, with your marriages, whatever's going on. It is the incorruptible seed. It moves forward. It holds. It, the Bible says in Mark 4:31, it is less than all. Less than all. Less than all for your financial troubles, for your marriage problems, for your relationship problems with your children, for your work issues, for your failing health, or troubles, or trials, or things that you may have go on. Oh, cancer, that's a big cat, no. But it is less than all. Less than all. That must see, what does the word say? Philippians 4:19. My God shall supply all your needs. All your needs. Needs. Takes care of the needs. My wife, a few years back, we went to Dr. White in Abilene. And she was checking, and she was trying to find out about her thyroid. She was having issues with her thyroid. When we were there, they found a mass on her thyroid. And it was growing up to be a concern. He wanted to remove this, but he was a praying doctor. And he says, you know what? We're going to pray. Would you mind if we prayed with you today? Yes! Let's pray! It's rare to find a doctor that even prays. He came and he prayed. He said, we want to pray for her. We're going to lift this up. We're going to pray and we're going to make a date. We're going to be on the safe side. God gave us a brain. We're going to schedule a date. We're going to remove this. We're going to remove this mass that's on her thyroid. But we are going to pray. We're going to pray and ask God's healing. God to work miraculously. To go through. I tell you, we prayed and we prayed, but we didn't think about it. We didn't get depressed over it. We didn't. No, we're just praying. It's in God's hand. We're going to move forward. When we came to church, we prayed about it. We said, Lord, we're going to lift this up. She's going to have this removed. We're going to pray. Just lift her up in prayer. We're going next week. We're going to get it done. We're praying about it. We came over there. We went to the doctor. And by the doctor, he said, he went over there. He laid her down on the table. We were looking. He said, I'm going to x-ray it first. We're going to look and see how big it is. And then we'll go in and we'll have it removed. So he went to x-ray. He came back out. He came back out and he says, you're never going to believe this. It is gone. It is gone. It's not there. It's so small. It's tiny. I can't even see it. I can't find it. I can't find it. Amen. Amen. But what does the scripture say? What does the scripture say? By his stripes, ye... Wait a second. By his stripes, he says, gonna? No. He says, we're healed. We're healed. You were healed. We got to believe it in faith. And say, no, we're praying for it. It's going to happen. We're going to move forward. You know, a lot of us say, well, maybe if God does it. Maybe if it's his will. If he does this, yeah, okay. No. We got to be a people of strong faith. And go by what the word says. By his stripes, you were healed. You were healed. You know what that big word went first in the beginning? Cancer. Cancer. You start thinking cancer. First thing, no. By his stripes, you're healed. By his stripes, you're healed. By his stripes, you're healed. Get louder on it. Get louder on it. Start praying with authority. You know what? And after it's gone, you go back and you're like, cancer. No. No way. It's done. It goes. No. By his stripes, you're healed. By his stripes. We pray, we claim it. And you know what? It is God's will. Some people don't go through that and don't get healed. Some people go through that and have, but don't let it break. There is a reason for it. You never know. There is something. You may be able to minister to somebody or encourage somebody and say, look, I've been there. I may be still going through it. I bought the t-shirt. But let me encourage you how I'm getting through it. Let me tell you how my Lord is helping me. Or let me tell you who he's brought me in contact with. Let me minister you where I found this. And start sharing what God is doing in your life. And understand that he works and he moves. But what? But it is when it is sown. It has to be sown. This word, it can't just sit there and just collect dust. You got to get in it. You got to be encouraged. Encourage one another. You know why God says that? Over and over. Because he knows that we're human and we forget. We forget. That's why we got to go through it. And that's why we come. The Bible says, forsake not the fellowship. Forsake not the fellowship. The reason why is because we encourage one another. You have no idea what the other person sitting next to you is going on behind closed doors. You have no idea what their struggles are, what their trials are. That person sitting next to you at work, you have no idea. Have compassion. Have mercy. Have grace. Those are important things because you have no idea. That person may be at the breaking point. But a kind word could change their heart. A kind word can move them to be encouraged. A kind word can say, you know what? I do need Jesus. I do need God. There's something different in her. There's something different in him. There's something going on in them. And a kind word can have the motion. And you know what all it is? Is the seed. You just throw the seed, and the seed grows. And it grows. Paul said, I have planted. Apollos has water, but what's the important part? But God gave the increase. God gave the increase. You can do all the work, but you know what? God does the increasing. God does the moving. God does the working. I got the life of God in me. Start claiming that. I got the life of God in me. I got the life of God in me. Well, you know what? When you put that seed in the ground and you put the dirt over it, oh, it's done. The devil's saying, oh, it's done. But I can hear that little seed saying, I got the life of God in me. I got the life of God in me. And he starts singing and moving. And what happens? He breaks through the soil. He can break through the concrete. We've seen that out there. Outside, you ever walk on a nice sidewalk and you see, boop, right through the concrete. How did that plant come through there? He broke through. You know what? God, his seed, it grows, and it becomes, the scripture says, Mark 4, it becomes. God speaks it. He moves it. It guides it. And understand, and it becomes. So what do we learn from Scripture? Psalms 18, 118, 17. I shall not die, but live, declares the works of the Lord. We claim the word. We need the word. It strengthens the word. It helps us. And when we call upon these promises, you say, no, I'm going to live. I'm going to proclaim this. Dear Lord, I'm not going to go through this trial. I'm not going to go through, not today, Satan. Not today, devil. I am going to declare your word. I am going to declare your works in my life. Jeremiah 5 and 22. Fear ye not me, saith the Lord. Will ye not tremble in my presence, which have placed the sand for the bound of the sea by its perpetual decree that it cannot pass it? And though the waves are tossed among themselves, yet they cannot prevail. They roar, yet they cannot pass over it. Did you know the tiny, tiny grain of sand was decreed by God? And God says, you tiny little piece of sand, you are decreed by me that the ocean will not prevail over you, that you will withhold the ocean's mighty roar, that you will stand back. I decree you the tiny grain of sand to hold back the mighty ocean. Did you know that? And then when the ocean, I can imagine it said, no, I'm going to roar. No, I'm going to storm. I'm going to go over you. And I'm going to go over with wave. I'm going to go over. But the sand, no. God spoke it. God decreed, you got to go back. 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 And then the ocean has to go back. It has to go back. It has to recede. It has to go back. You know why? Because God decreed the tiny, tiny grain of sand. You cannot prevail. It has to go back. It has to go back. The tiny grain of sand. Remember that. Like the seed. Let it grow. Let it grow. We sometimes get caught up. Oh, it's too big of a problem. Oh, it's too much. It's too big for me to handle. No. That problem has to go back. It has to go back. God is good. God is powerful. God is mighty. He is strong. I trust in his word. It is strengthening me. It got to go back. Call upon the decree. call upon the victory. That little grain of sand, it can hold back. It'll hold back because God decreed the ocean to be at its bay, to hold back. Remember that. Jeremiah chapter 5. Jeremiah chapter 5, 22. It has to go back. It has to. God has decreed it. But there's some of us that were held back. We're held back. We're thinking the problem is too big. It's too much. But it's time for the Word of God to grow in you. It is time for the Word of God to grow in you. This is your opportunity. This is your chance. He said, no, no. I'm going through. You just don't know, Brother Danny, what I'm going through. You don't know what's going on. Those of you that are streaming, that are watching, that you tuned in, you're like, no. If only you knew what my life was. If only you knew what was going on. It's okay. It's okay. God knows. God knows. You don't have to give it and tell it to me. You tell it to Jesus. You give it to Him. If you're watching right there today, you're streaming today, you don't have to write it to me. You don't have to tell it to me. You don't have to text it to me. You don't have to email it to me. No. You give it straight to Jesus. He is a personal God. And He wants to have a relationship with each and every one of us. There may be somebody in here saying, you know what, Brother Danny? I know I'm saved. I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. But I'm not walking like I should be. I'm not as close as I once was. God is here. All you got to do is just walk right back. He's never left. He's always here. Give that opportunity to Him. Give Him that chance today. Make it right with Him. You can walk out these doors and not know Jesus, and something happened to you. Don't you want to have that blessed assurance? Don't you want to know that if I was to die today, where I would go? Well, you can know that today by just inviting Him in. Inviting Him in. I'm going to ask all heads bowed, all eyes closed, no one looking around. This is your time to talk with God. If somebody's here and say, Brother Danny, I'm not going through anything. I just want prayer. You can lift your hand and I will pray for you. God bless you. I see that hand. God bless you. God bless you. I see that hand. God bless you. God bless you. I see that hand. I lift you up. I lift you up in prayers. For the rest of us are here. This is between you and Jesus. Between you and the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we understand what you did on the cross. We understand that you paid the ultimate price for all of us. Your blood was shed to cover our sins, past, present, and future. Your word says that you died for us while we were yet in our worst. We claim the blood of Jesus. We claim your coming. We invite you into our hearts. We ask you to be our Lord. We ask that we rededicate ourselves to you in our life and our walk. We thank you, Jesus, for what you've done and what you continue to do in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. For those of you at home, if you said that prayer, we believe that you've been born again. I want to encourage you, if you don't have a Bible, you can download the Bible app. It is for free. Start your journey with Jesus in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We want to encourage you. Your life will never be the same. And God bless you. For those of you that are here today, God bless you for coming. I hope it was an encouraging morning for you so much. Miss Pat, do you have some blessed good words for us before we leave today?
If you had a bad day the last year, the last month, the last week, we all look back and there's some days that just nothing went right. We're always glad when that day is finished, aren't we? We experience bad days in our life. That's just part of life. And how we endure them determines our faith in God. Remember, tell yourself, this doesn't last forever. It too will pass. And it's true. You'll look back and think, there was a silver lining and life goes on. We need the physical, emotional, and spiritual food to get us through that mountain of bad days. Dr. Jeremiah shares this thought, and this is, I wrote it down in the front of one of my Bibles because to me it just has so much strength. Our faith isn't a luxury to be experienced in the good times. we need it mostly when we seek encouragement during the bad times. Seek God and He will be near. And one of my little gems that it means a lot to me, and it's also written in my Bible, the perfect heart of God. What God gives us is a perfect heart. I'm on my way to a better life. I'm not where I need to be, but thank God I'm better off than